Okay, I will start. So today I will explain the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, and in fact some result which is stronger than Riemann-Hilbert, as we shall see. And the plan of the proof is the same as in the irregular case. But in the regular case it's much easier because we work with the sheaf of OT, of temperate holomorphic function, and in the that's for regular. And for irregular, you will have this horrible thing that Masaki will explain. E is for enhanced. Okay, but this is later, next week. Okay. So I have to, maybe it's a good, maybe it's useful to recall what is irregular holonomic D-module, to give a definition. Okay. So X is a complex manifold, and you have OX, DX, mod coherent D-module, holonomic D-module, and inside you have the category of regular holonomic D-module. So I give a definition. So call lambda the characteristic variety of M in T star X. So it closed. So we assume that M is holonomic. Okay. So lambda is a closed complex analytic, conic for the C star action, C star conic. And a priori, if we are here, it's co-isotropic. Okay. So a lot of people say it's co-isotropic by Gaber's theorem, but this theorem is due to Sato, Kawai, Kashiwara. And later Gaber gave a purely algebraic proof, but the original proof is to Sato, Kawai, Kashiwara. So if we are here, then it's Lagrangian. That's the definition. Okay. So a module is holonomic if the characteristic variety is Lagrangian. So the question is, what means regular holonomic? So denote by I lambda the ideal of the gre dx, okay, of functions vanishing f restricted to lambda equal zero. Okay, the defining ideal of the Lagrangian manifold lambda. Then, so the definition is now M is regular holonomic if locally on X there exists a good filtration such that I lambda apply to the graded of M is zero. Or if you prefer, if locally there exists a good filtration which is reduced. Okay. Okay, so that's the first definition. So it's a theorem that I don't prove it here, which is due to Kashiwara, I guess. Maybe there are other people work on this, that mod regular holonomic of dx is a sick abelian subcategory unstable by a lot of things, by duality, proper direct image, duality for D module. Okay, I don't give all definition now, all result now.
So it turns out, I believe that there is some sort of canonical global filtration. So
that's another problem.
So that for proper maps, to prove the finiteness, there is no problem because of this filtration. Because usually for proper maps to prove finiteness, you need some kind of good filtration. At least if you're in a Dirac setup, either you are in a Dirac setup, or the complex setup, then you need some technical condition, which is probably, so then when you say this theorem about proper maps in the complex case, you have to...
Of course, when we take proper map, we need good filtration. But, okay, we will come back later when we shall need it. And if I have time, I will construct not a functorial filtration, but it's another. Okay, so I don't insist on this because it will be another course, and it's considered as classical, more or less. Maybe I should mention also here Kawai, because there is a paper Kashiwara Kawai, which is called Regular Holonomic 3. Well, anyway, so we shall use these things. So I recall a result that I mentioned last week about the properties. Ah, no, first I give a definition again. So you take D, a normal crossing divisor. So we choose coordinates x1, xn, local coordinate, and x such that D is given by x1, xr equals 0. And we say that M has regular normal form along D if it is isomorphic, or if it's a local coordinate system, M is D Z power lambda. So let's call with lambda equal lambda 1 lambda R in C minus no positive integer. So what does it? So is that clear?
Z is X. Yes. The coordinates are...
Ah, X becomes Z. Okay. Sorry. Okay. So it means XI DZI minus lambda I for I equal 1 to R. On dzj for g equal r plus 1 n. Okay, you take this ideal on m is d over I lambda. Okay, so regular normal form is very explicit and very easy to calculate. So the game is to reduce regular holonomic D module to regular normal form. So there is a, I don't know, a lemma or a theorem, as you want. Consider a property PXM. So it's a statement on X for all M regular holonomic. So we assume that Px is local. Maybe I wrote it last week. It means that, maybe I write it, Pxm is true if and only if for any x, for any covering then assume that it's invariant by shift. It's invariant by shift. It's stable by distinguished triangle. If you have a distinguished triangle, if you have Pxm and Pxm prime, then you have Pxm double prime.
Yes, you show more theoretical one because abelian category is not loose, it's triangulated. Where is triangulated? I think abelian category, no, but shift.
Ah, so it's in the derived category, excuse me. Okay. You are right, thank you. The derived category.
So this is
it's commode.
Some statement.
No, this is, you understand what it means, of course, because this one is 6, so it means the full subcategory.
I suppose implicitly that it depends only on the isomorphism class of M.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, okay. Otherwise you get things.
Absolutely, I forgot to say that.
And is it M? It's local.
It's local, invariant by shift, invariant by.
This was M, she said. Okay. Invariant by shift.
So there is a condition which is useless here. Maybe I should not write it, but it will be useful in the irregular case. So if you have Px m plus m prime, then it implies Px m. In the regular case, I think we don't use that, but it's so natural. And it's so now comes the two main properties. In practice, these properties are absolutely obvious to check. Maybe I write here. I want to keep this blackboard.
So which kind of property in practice you would consider?
Riemann-Hilbert, for example. I will apply this to prove Riemann-Hilbert. So I've not finished. If F is a projective map, then if the property Pxm is true, then Px, Py of the direct image of M is true. And here we assume that M also is good.
But isn't it automatic because of...
No, it is automatic, but when you don't use it, it's automatic, okay? It's known that regular holonomic modules are good, but we don't use it. So we assume that the...
What is it good for?
Good, it means you have a good filtration, but not everywhere, on each compact set. Each open relatively compact set. It's enough. Not globally, semi-globally. On the last one, the best, if M has regular normal form, then Pxm holds. So, if you skip the first property, which are more or less obvious, the important property is stable by proper direct image, and you have to check it in the normal form case. Okay. So I give a glance, a sketch of proof.
So the lemma, the conclusion is that if it's all of this, then...
Yeah, I forgot the conclusion. Yeah, I forgot. So what is the idea of the proof? So first, assume that D is a normal crossing, divisor, on M is a regular holonomic, on X, and also which satisfy two things. M is equal to its localization along D, and there is no singularity apart from D. Or if you prefer, M is a flat connection on X minus D. Then P of X M yeah, so in this case I how can I prove the result? Okay, I assume all conditions are satisfied. So locally it's there exists a filtration, not a good filtration, a filtration of by D module, M equal M0 contain M1, contain MG, contain MJ plus 1 equal 0, such that MJ divided by MJ plus 1 has regular normal form. Honestly, Keshura told me it's very classical, but I believe him. I've never seen the proof, but for specialists of this question, it's very classical. Okay, so you reduce by this result. The result is proved in this case. Okay, so how to pass from this case to the general one? Using this singularization, so I don't give the proof. I just give an idea of the proof. Okay, and je triche, comment dire? I cheat. Okay, so more or less, you make an induction on the dimension of the support of M, and you will construct a morphism. So support of M containing Z. So you will make a desingularization. So that W is smooth, D as normal is a normal crossing divisor, and then what you do? So assume, so it's where I cheat because otherwise it's a little more complicated. Assume for simplicity that z equal x. and call this F. Then you will use this some triangle like that. You take the direct image, inverse image of M, localized. It's not the same D, it's horrible, on N. So it's just an idea of the proof, it's not a proof.
But Z you choose, no?
Z is the support of M. So I assume.
The support, yeah. Exactly equal to support. It's contained.
Oh. Contained, it doesn't matter.
But you can choose X.
Yeah, but I do an induction by induction. Okay, so support. Okay, so for short, I assume Z equal X. So you do something like that. And here, this one is case A. And when you take the direct image, you apply one of the properties, property E. Okay. So you take the, so this, the, this module will satisfy the property. Okay, for this one. And for this one, the support of N is contained in S. So by induction, it will satisfy also the property. And the property is stable by triangle.
Your notation for the operations in D modules.
It's not mine, I hate this notation.
No, because what I remember is that there is, well, I. So the usually the each operation is two versions. I mean, there is like for sheaves, F plus star, F plus sheaf.
Yeah, but not for D module. It's just a shift. It doesn't change. For D module, there is only one inverse image up to a shift. There are not two inverse images.
Ah, but for direct image, you have.
And for direct, we take direct image when it's proper. So you have two notations, but in practice, they are the same. We never take direct image when it's not proper.
Okay,
excuse me,
so I got confused maybe before.
Yeah. No, for D module, there is one direct image, essentially, and one inverse image. Okay, so it's the idea of the proof, it's not the proof, okay? So now I want to apply this big lemma to Riemann-Hilbert. Ah, no, before, excuse me. Before, there is something rather boring to do, which is to blow up, real blow up. So what I'm doing now will be used by Masaki intensively, and I think it's here again. It's very classical. It's like polar coordinates, but with more variables. Okay. So some, maybe some notation. So we take this action, positive number cross C star cross R to C star cross R. So A Z T gives A Z A minus 1 T. A is real positive. Okay. So we denote by C see what? Tilde tot. This is C times cross R divided by this action. And we also need the most important one, this one. C times R positive divided by this action. And also C tilde positive equal C times R positive divided by this action. Okay. So the important one is this one. Okay. And well. So now if X is C R cross Cn minus R, and you have D, the divisor Z1 that are equal to 0. Then you define x tilde tot as c tilde tot power r cross c and minus r, x tilde and x tilde positive. Okay. Similar. Okay. Yeah, I'm obliged to erase this blackboard. And we have a map, pi, which goes from C tilde tot to C, to Z T gives TZ. Okay. So this map, we find a map, we keep the same notation, from X tilde to X. And here, you have X tilde positive, which is isomorphic to x minus d. Here is the situation. Okay. So if you take n equal 1, you will see that it's exactly polar coordinates. This is x tilde. Okay, so x tilde tot is not intrinsically defined. But if you have a normal crossing divisor, x tilde is intrinsically defined. Okay? And this one is only defined as a germ in the neighborhood of this manifold with boundary. Okay? And now we put sheaves here. Maybe I skip some details. Essentially, I will define O T X tilde as pi upper shriek O where is that? X T. So you take temperate holomorphic function with poles on D. And this is invert image. And it will be it can be shown. So of course, this map pi tilde is proper. Okay, we use it always, of course. And we can prove it's not. Okay, and A x tilde is alpha O T x tilde. So this is a usual sheaf. It's a usual sheaf of holomorphic function with temperate growth at the boundary of the manifold with boundary. And D, what is the notation? A, X tilde, is A, X tilde, tensor with pi minus 1 O X, pi minus 1, dx. So we will do d module on this manifold with boundary, x tilde. Okay. So why is it so useful? Maybe I give the theorem without proof. So it's an exercise, it's more or less obvious. Proposition or lemma. If L has regular normal form along D, so L is a dx module. Then, when I maybe I should have defined it. If L is a dx module, I set LA, by definition, it's Where is that? Where is LA? It's DXA till tensor over pi minus 1 dx pi minus 1 L. Okay. So when you have a D module here, you associate a dx tilde module on this manifold with boundary. Okay. And the result, if L has regular normal form on D, then locally on x tilde, LA is isomorphic to OA. That is A. So once you have make this desingularization, not desingularization, this blow up, D module with regular normal forms become flat connection. Okay. Why is that true? It's more or less obvious. It is the reason is that Z power lambda is locally invertible in the x tilde A. Or in A. Okay. You see Z power lambda, if you work locally, it's an invertible function. Okay. So maybe I skip some details to state the main result. And I will come back to the details later.
But here, really, you don't need all this temperate. It's too big for this. So just to realize this result here,
yeah.
It's...
What is too big?
The ring you are on, this complex one. You are enlarging to OT. OT. Yeah. You can adjust... So
this one is not too big, we need it.
You need a plate, but for this thing here, you need much less than this.
So it's simply that Z power lambda, which is not invertible outside of zero, is invertible on the blow up. That's all. Maybe I state the main theorem. Alors, theorem. All these things, needless to say, are not due to me, but to Kashiwara. It's an old result from... Maybe it's a new formulation with OT, but essentially it was due to Kashiwara, at least the two first ones. So you take L, which is regular holonomic. Then, the first result is the temperate de Ram. I don't remember my notation. Is isomorphic to the usual de Ram. And the second one is the same for solution. So these two statements are equivalent, of course, by duality, okay? Because it's a statement for all regular holonomic D module, and you pass from de Ram to solution by duality. Okay? So it's the same statement formulated differently. And the other one, so this one, I did it with Kashiwara, and it's stronger than Riemann-Hilbert, as we shall see. If you take OT, derive tensor product as a D module with L, it's isomorphic to R ohm sol of L with value in OT.
You take the derived tensor product?
No, this is the tensor product as a D module. Of course, everything is derived. It's not the tensor product over D, huh? It's the tensor product over O, but with a structure of a D module. Of course, it's derived, huh? Otherwise, it has. So, before to go further, I want to to show you that this is a deep result. So, why is it Riemann-Hilbert first?
Sorry, but with this plot procedure, do you have something like the functor muom for D modules or not?
Muom for D modules.
You mean it's kind of specialization?
No, no, there is no macro-localization here. Where have you seen
taking the blow-up, you cannot localize and...
No, I don't know what you mean, but... of course, Kashura, when in his study of holonomic D-module with Kawai, made a macro-local study using macro-differential operators. But here, it does not appear. Okay, so let me give some application of this result, in particular to non-holomorphic functions. Okay. Let me give some application of this result to show you that they are deep, very strong results. Okay. So the first application, see, you apply the functor alpha x to the isomorphism 3. When you apply alpha, it commutes to tensor product, and alpha of OT is O. So alpha of OXT tensor L is L. So you find that L is R ohm sol L O X T. So this is Riemann-Hilbert by Kashiwara in 84 or 80 even in 80. Okay, Kashiwara, this thing was denoted T ohm by Kashiwara at this time. Okay, so it means that you recover L from the knowledge of the sheaf of solution.
So he did not have OXT at that time, exactly.
No, you need OXT. Let me take an example. Assume that M L is HD Z OX. Okay. Then sol L will be the constant sheaf on Z up to some shift. Okay. So R ohm sol L OX is HD Z OX. And if you put OT, then you find HD algebraic cohomology. That's why you need OT. Okay.
So how did he formulate it originally?
Originally, Kashiwara defined a functor that he called T ohm, which was defined on the category of considerable sheaves, and he proved it with this functor T ohm. Okay? But T ohm is a particular case of R ohm with value in OT.
Ah, okay, but
there
is the ad hoc way to.
Because T ohm F Ox. So this is but of course all the IHES are in TM. Okay, so let us give another application. So as a particular case of this formula 3, we recover Riemann-Hilbert, okay? This is the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. Okay. So let's give another application of 2. I take a R constructible sheaf. And I apply R ohm F to this isomorphism 2. Okay. So I find that R ohm over D L R ohm F OT is isomorphic to R ohm over D M R ohm F OX. So why is it M on L? Why? So on the hypothesis that L is regular holonomic. So let's take a particular case. Take M, real analytic manifold, X a complexification of M, and take for F, the dual over X of the content sheaf on M. Then the left hand side is R ohm over D of L in the sheaf of distribution. And it's isomorphic to R ohm L in the sheaf of Sato's hyperfunction. So you see, this is a very strong result because so this result here contains all these regularity results that you can guess. It proves that if M is holonomic, the complex of distribution solution is the same as the complex of hyperfunction solution. With the same techniques, we can prove the same for infinity and real analytic also. On another example, take F, the constant sheaf on Z, then you find R ohm L algebraic cohomology supported by Z.
There is also a comparison with solutions in the formal series.
Yeah.
The completion, does it follow from this kind of thing?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Not directly. But you can deduce. You can deduce by duality, for example. That's the shortest. All these comparison results are contained.
So you can also do like completion along the sub-variety. Yeah. Which is the point, but along and then it is also true. It is like the old results on the Drunk homology.
No, you can prove something like that. R ohm over D L beta of OX is isomorphic to R ohm over D L O Whitney. Okay. So when you apply this to, then you find things like that, R ohm over D L O X restricted to Z is isomorphic to R ohm d m l o x formal completion, you know, that. That was your question. Okay, so maybe I will enter the proof of the result, at least the first two isomorphisms. So, okay. So you see, with this language of Indsheaves, OT or OW, it contains a lot of results. This isomorphism is very strong. It contains a lot of things. So, let me give a sketch of proof. Maybe I want to write down the Riemann-Hilbert. Because I will keep it. Okay, all the results are here. Okay. Okay, so. So we have seen that the two statements one and two are equivalent, okay, by duality. Okay, so we just prove one. So we have to check all properties that I erased of the lemma. Okay, so the first one are obvious. Okay, there are only two properties which are not obvious: direct image and regular normal form. Okay. So what about direct image? I have to prove that if Pxm is true, then Px, the direct image, is true, assuming f x to y is a projective and m is a good okay. But if you remember, the Durham of the direct image is a direct image under this hypothesis of the Durham of L. We have seen that. It was a consequence of temperate Grauert theorem. At this level. And the same without temperate is true. This is not so easy. Again, it's used Grauert, but not temperate. Maybe not. It's not easy, but it's old. Okay, so
you mean the usual Grauert for coherent sheaves, not yeah. anything.
Not for D-module, but it's easy to pass from coherent sheaves to D-module.
If you have a good...
Yeah, but we have a good filtration. It's not written now, but it was written in the statement of the lemma. We assume it's written? Good. Yeah, it's written. We assume M is good. Okay. So we see that the property is stable by direct image. So finally, we have to check the property for a normal form. Okay, in the case of regular normal form. Cannot, you want really? It says that if you have f from x to y, if f is coherent on x, f is proper on support of f, then the direct image of f tensor Oxt is no, we have to do again the proof. It does not, unfortunately. Okay, so what I have to do now? Okay, I erase this. I want to prove. So now we assume that L has regular normal form along D. And we want to prove that L, that omega T x tensor dx L so I recall we have x tilde to x pi x tilde positive x minus d, and this is an isomorphism. Okay. And there is some. So there is some technical parts that I. So this is a Durham temperate of L. So I skip a technical point, which is not difficult, but it's too many things. I skip that R pi star pi upper shriek of Durham temperate of L is isomorphic to Durham temperate of L. Okay. It's some technical lemma. So what do I want to prove? So I want to prove that this thing, so the question is, this thing is isomorphic to alpha of the same thing, is a sheaf. I want to prove that, maybe I write it here. This is alpha of the Durham temperate of L. So I want to prove that this object is isomorphic to alpha I never write iota, of course, although it has no meaning to say it's alpha. It's because I don't write iota. Okay, but alpha commutes with a direct proper with this functor. Okay. So it's enough to prove that the inverse image of the RAM temperate of L is a usual sheaf. Is a usual sheaf. It's not an N-sheaf. It's equal to alpha. But this, we can calculate. So the inverse image of the RAM temperate of L is isomorphic to maybe of course it's difficult to follow like that because there are a lot of technical things hidden. So roughly speaking, you will find omega t x tilde tensor over d a l a. And now we use the fact that L has regular normal form. So this is isomorphic to O a. So finally, this is isomorphic as the inverse image of omega x t tensor over dx ox locally, and this is okay. So it's a sheaf. So it's what I've done. I said that after the blow up, my D module is nothing but the flat connection. Oh. Okay, and then it's put. Okay, so maybe we may have a stop here. And I will prove the third part after. And I will give an application and examples. Mainly what I will do after is to treat an example of irregular D module to see what happens. Okay, so we have a short break. So now it's not in the, it will not be in the notes what I will say now, but it's one of my ideas since very long that I like. It's how to undo D module, holonomic D module, with good filtration. So I take this last formula. You have L. And I want to undo L with a good filtration, or with a filtration, let's say, but functorial. So an idea is to undo OXT with a filtration. Okay. So what does it mean to have a filtration on this strange object of a temperate holomorphic function with holomorphic function with temperate growth? So OXT is the Dolbeau complex of temperate distribution. Okay. And distribution have a very classical filtration by Sobolev spaces. Okay. So I don't know how to. So now I take a real manifold. So, is it possible? So the problem is that on the subanalytic side, you have the pre-sheaf of sub-LF spaces. S is negative. Don't ask me the definition of sub-LF space. But we know it exists. Okay, so we have this pre, but this pre-sheaf is not a sheaf. So it's difficult to undo the sheaf of distribution on the subanalytic site with a filtration because they are not sheaves.
Usually, subanalytic space is done on RM.
No, on manifold.
Manifold that you use. But when you have things with subanalytic boundary,
yeah, okay.
What do you think exactly about the boundary? So you have to.
Okay, so let me explain what exists. Okay, so the subanalytic site is not enough on with Guillermo. We construct the linear subanalytic site. So what is a linear subanalytic site? The open set are the same. But the covering are different. U1, U2 is a linear, we call it linear covering of U1 union U2 if there exists a constant C, such that the distance of x to m minus u1 union u2 is less or equal C, distance x m minus u1 plus distance x m minus u2. That's why linear, because with Lajacevic inequality, there was some constant n here. But we assume n equal 1. Okay. So there are very few coverings. Okay. But with this covering, you can define sub-LF sheaves.
The sub-LF space itself. Is it, let us say U is relatively compact in Rn with subanalytic, like what you said.
Yeah.
So do you take the one for Rn is supporting U in some sense, or the closure of certain?
Okay, as I said at the beginning, don't ask me what is the exact definition of sub-LF. I just tell you what exists. So there exists a sheaf which is constructed by Lobo, which is a sheaf on the linear subanalytic site. On, okay, on which, let me 1 second to finish my sentence and it will become clear, okay? And you have direct image. Let's call it rho again. So I work here unbounded or bounded from below. And so this is, it's partly my work with Guillermo and partly the work of Lebeau. At this stage, it's my work with Guillermo. So by the Brown theorem, there exists a left adjunct to the direct image. Okay. So you can define the subanalytic sheaves on the subanalytic site as the rho upper shriek of the sheaf constructed by Lobo.
This would be now just a derived category.
Yeah, so they are object of derived category. Okay, but the good news, the theorem, if U is subanalytic with Lipschitz boundary, then R gamma U of the subalef sheaves is in degree zero and is equal to the usual subalef space. I changed my notation. What do you say? Qu'est-ce que j'ai fait? No, that I have not defined. No. Okay?
S negative,
real negative. Okay. Anyway, there is something in mathematics which is called the usual subalef spaces, okay, which is horrible, except, but when you, no, it's not horrible, but what we prove is if U is Lipschitz, then it's the good definition. If U is not Lipschitz, it's not the good definition.
What do you mean Lipschitz boundary? Yeah. Locally, it's
by a Lipschitz invertible function, it's a half space. By Lipschitz change of coordinates, it's a half space. So it shows that the subalef spaces are naturally objects of derived category. They are not spaces. They are okay. Okay. And once you have subalef,
this thing is required to be subanalytic or not?
Yeah. Absolutely. We have written the theory for subanalytic. Maybe you can generalize.
That is, no, but the question is whether if there is a bi-Lipschitz homeomorphism, whether there is a subanalytic one or you assume there is a subanalytic.
I don't remember this point. Huh? Maybe you ask the graph of phi to be subanalytic. I don't remember. Okay. Anyway, when U is Lipschitz, this object of derived category is concentrated in degree zero and it's the classical one. So finally, you see that you have a subalef filtration on dB. So if you look at this, maybe I need I somewhere. It's an AND object of D module, of filt. So of course it needs much of, lot of development. But we can define the derived category of filtered D module. It's not abelian, of course, but it works. On AND object of D module, on distribution are well defined, EBT. I forgot the T, very important. So by taking Dolbo, we see that OXT is well defined in the derived category of D and DX module. And once you have a filtration on OT, by this formula, you have a filtration in some sense on D. So of course, you can ask me, what can you say about this filtration? Is it in degree zero, I guess, very rarely. Is it good in some sense? But here, of course, we cannot say anything. So it was I told you, it is a parenthesis, okay?
Sorry, at this point, you take quasi-abelian categories, or?
No, I have not defined this, but it's easy to define the derived category with Schneiders, who have written some paper on this subject.
Ah, this filtration with the maps, you mean?
Filtration,
yeah.
What's
not in
FIDX?
Filtered and object of D module. No, I'm not precise here. It's just to show you that maybe it's interesting, maybe it's not. Okay. And
so this does not give, for regular thing, it doesn't give the canonical good filtration? No.
I don't know if there is canonical good filtration, but this one is functorial. Maybe, but it's in the derived category.
No, but I remember vaguely that there was for regular, holonomic regular, there was a way to.
Yeah, but it constructed at hands by, you know, like.
But also, this is Kashavar conjectures problem, which is that consider holes to distributions.
Yeah.
You get a holonomic module, it's a complex conjugate manifold.
Yeah.
And then distributions, of course, consider holes to dimensions.
Yeah, but it's another thing. And maybe, I don't know, maybe this filtration works also in the irregular case. You replace T by E, but it's... anyway, it's too... when we want to prove something, we need a result of analysis that we don't know. So we have not been very far.
Okay. There was also this thing I remember of the L2 lattice.
Of what?
L2 lattice? No, but there are a lot of filtration on D modules. Each mathematician has constructed this filtration. Okay, so I give mine. Okay, it's a parenthesis. Okay, so maybe before to come back to the subject, I want to make another parenthesis, more interesting maybe. I want to discuss an explicit example of irregular D module. Okay, so until now, we have spoken of regular D module. What happens with irregular? So it's an example that I think which is illuminating for what Kashura will do next week. So we will look at the simplest example. So dimension is 1. So it's something I I did with Kashiwara in 03. And I think it contains a lot of information that will be generalized after by D'Agnolo and Kashiwara. So x is c, you know. I know in algebraic geometry you say A1 C, but I call it C for short. U, so the coordinate is Z. U is C minus 0. J is embedding. And my D module is this one, is associated to this equation. Simplest one. So M is D over DXP, or if you prefer, it's D exponential, which sign? 1 over Z. So I want to try to understand this sheaf. Okay. First, I will try to understand H0 of this. That is the kernel, okay. So sol t is a complex OT, OT. And first I will try to calculate the kernel. Okay. So OT is concentrated in degree 0, and it's a sub-unsheaf of OX. OT in degree 0, because the dimension of x is 1. Other one, OT is complicated. It's an object of the... Okay. Okay, so let's call Maybe I will call sol 0. No. Okay. So H 0 of sol t of x is a subsheaf of, or subanalytic of H 0 sol x of m. So when this is not zero, on an open set V, yeah, maybe I should say first that H zero of sol, the classical sheaf of solution, is a constant sheaf on U. That's an easy calculation. And this one is not zero, if and only if V is contained in U, if, V is subanalytic by definition. Right? And also, exponential 1 over Z, this function restricted to V, is temperate. This is more or less tautological. Okay, you, we look at the temperate solution of this equation. Okay, the solution of this equation are exponential 1 over Z with a constant, so it has to be temperate. So, on this function exponential restricted to V is temperate if and only if partie réelle one over Z is bounded on V. Otherwise, it will not be temperate. And this is bounded if and only if V is contained, if and only if there exists epsilon positive, such that V is contained in some U epsilon, where U epsilon is a set of Z in C, such that I prefer to make a picture. U epsilon is C minus B epsilon, or B epsilon is a closure if the ball closed ball centered at epsilon on radius epsilon. Okay, so I make a picture. So here is and this is U epsilon. Okay. So with this remarks, we find that maybe I skip some detail. We find that sol t of d exponential 1 over z.
Do you mean bounded above or bounded?
Above.
Bounded above, the real part. Otherwise, the.
No. 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 No, bonded, not above. You want this to be temperate, so the real part should be bonded.
No, when you say bounded, means absolute value is bounded, or?
No, it's original, it's real part, it's less.
No, not absolute.
Okay, bounded in this sense.
So finally, I skip some details, we find that this is an inductive limit in the subanalytic topology of the constant sheaf and U epsilon. So I recall U epsilon so we have an explicit description of the complex of solution of this irregular D module. Okay. So of course if we take alpha this is the classical things. But it's clear that with a temperate holomorphic function, we have much more information. So what is good and what is not good in this result? So with this, this is much more precise than the classical, this result. Okay? But it's not so good, the bad things, bad news is that if you take d exponential 1 over z and d exponential 2 over z, they have same temperate solution. Okay? So temperate holomorphic functions are not enough, or C maybe, are not precise enough to distinguish this kind of d module. Okay? But good, if you take d 1 over z on d exponential 1 over z squared, for example, then the solutions are different. So it's a tool to distinguish a lot of d modules, but unfortunately, not all d modules. Okay. Okay, so I have made two parentheses, maybe too much. And perhaps I can come back to my proof. Okay, so it's the end of the parentheses. It's I think this example with Kashiwa, you will see the more general example exponential d exponential phi, where phi is meromorphic. And he will calculate the solution sheaf of this. Okay, it's more difficult, but it's very similar to this calculation. Okay, so maybe I come back. There is something else I want to do. I think I will not give the proof of the third. I think you are tired, me too. So I will give an application, another application of this result. Okay?
The proof is the same lemma, yeah,
check. The proof is the same line. You show it, both terms are stable by direct image, and you test in the regular case. In the normal case, regular normal case. No, I want to. I almost forgot. There is something important that I want to do. I want to apply this result. To integral transform. So in the regular case. So integral transform means a correspondence, okay, in the complex analytic case. Okay. So you have manifolds and morphism of manifolds. So they are all complex manifolds. And I want to compare, I want to see what happens to the Durham complex of a holonomic D-module on X when I go to Y by inverse and direct image. So I introduce. So M will be a D-module on X, L a D-module on S. Then I define the composition as a D-module. So you take the inverse image, the direct image. And for sheaves, if I have a sheaf, so if L is a sheaf or n sheaf, and F is a n sheaf on X, maybe I take G on Y, I define a psi L of G as as a direct image of R I om L inverse image of F. And maybe I define also L composed with G equal R F. For G. Okay. So there is a theorem which now it's just a corollary of all what I have said. So theorem is the following. You take M, a good, not good, quasi good is enough, D module. You take a regular holonomic kernel. And you take as a sheaf Roman L as the solution of L. Inductive limit, filtrant inductive limit of good. Okay? La quasi coherent.
The homology
sheaves are okay. Okay, the homology sheaves. It's a 6 subcategory. Okay. On the hypothesis, we assume that G, the projection, is proper on F minus 1 support of M intersect support of L. Some properness. Then the conclusion, if you take the Durham complex, temperate Durham complex of M, and you make its image by psi, then it's isomorphic to the temperate Durham complex of the image of M by L.
So M is not holonomic at all?
L is regular holonomic, the kernel. So unfortunately, it does not apply to the Laplace transform, which is not a regular holonomic kernel. But it applies to many situations. So first, I say, maybe I skip the detail, that all ingredients of the proof have been given already. Okay? Because we have to prove that essentially Durham temperate. So, yeah, also a remark, this result is false without temperate. Okay? It can be make true with other hypotheses. Okay? But with this hypothesis, it's false if you remove temperate. Okay? And what is, we have seen, what does it say, essentially, the proof? It says that Durham temperate commutes with first inverse image then commutes with a tensor product with L as a D module tensor product over D. Okay. So this was not written down. It is in the notes, it will be, but this last result is almost a consequence of this one. I don't give the details, but it follows easily from this formula. So this is this formula 3 is a generalized Riemann-Hilbert. It's much stronger than Riemann-Hilbert. Okay. And it commutes with direct image. Okay. On this, we have seen many times. Okay. Temperate Grauer, things like that. Okay. So once you know that Durham commutes with all these things, then you have this formula. Okay. So maybe I want to translate it. Ah, maybe. Yeah. Let me put it here. Yes. Maybe, yeah. Excuse me. Yeah, maybe I write again everything here. CL of Durham M is isomorphic to Durham. And maybe I forgot a shift. Huh? That's, yeah. Okay. I forgot to put a shift. Durham of M composed with L. And there is a shift. Here, dx minus ds, that I forgot. So, before to erase, I correct dx minus ds. Okay. So now it's true, I can erase. Okay, so okay, and we assume that G is proper on F minus 1 support of M. Intersect support of L. L is dB reg all ds. Okay, so to conclude, let's translate this. So I have erased it, but if you remember, psi on phi are adjoint.
By the way, when you have quasi good, so it's a filtered limit of good, the support, is it, how is it defined? Is it the direct limit of the support or the
cross? The support of a sheaf is the support of the sheaf. Huh?
So there is one way where you take the point of the.
No, you take the closure of the. I don't know. Okay, so if I translate this. So now I take G, another unsheaf. Then, as a particular case of this formula, I find Rm ICX L composed with G, with value in omega x t tensor dxm. I write everything dx minus ds is isomorphic to Rm I cy g omega y t tensor dy of M composed with L. Okay, so why are such formulas interesting? Because in the literature, you meet very often a particular case of results like that. Okay, here is a formula with temperate. There exists a formula without temperate with other hypotheses. But let's just give an example. For example, if you take projective duality, the incident relation, then you find formula which says that R om L composed with G with O Pn of C, some line bundle maybe with some shift is isomorphic to R om G O pista and C with a. These are line bundles, okay? And there is a sheaf that I don't remember. So you have this adjunction formula where G is any sheaf, and you pass from one sheaf on the projective space. G is a sheaf on the dual space. And so you can particularize, take open set, and so. And it contains a lot of information.
What is the K and K star here?
K is an integer, it's a line bundle, and I don't remember the formula. K star is deduced from K by some minus K plus N or something like that. So I want these formulas are classical. Maybe they are in Brzezinski already. But it's just to emphasize the interest of these general formulas, adjunction formulas. And I think this kind of formula with Rm here, there are many formulas in the literature like that. And I wrote some with D'Agnolo long ago, on Kashiwara, Tanizaki. But I think it's the first time that we write them like that, without applying to a constructible sheaf. So I think it's a nice formula, and it's still better in the irregular case, because then you can apply to Laplace transform, but it's much more difficult, and it's what Kashiwara will do next week. So maybe I have 10 minutes before my time, but I think I've finished now.
So what is the L here? The L is given by?
By the incidence relation. It's you have a Z containing P N cross. The incidence relation on L, you have some choice. You can take H1, Z. There are many choices. Or you can take the constant sheaf or something like that. That's the Radon transform in this case. Of course, you can take other flag correspondence. For example, the Penrose construction of the wave equation is something like that, with you take P3 M4, you start with a line bundle, and here you find the wave equation. You know, M4 is a Minkowski for space compactified, compactified Minkowski space. It's also, no, it's just to say, I don't want, it's another subject, I don't want to enter it. M4 is a flag manifold F1, 2 of C4.
Okay, so this will not be in the notes?
No.
And the incidence relation will be in the notes?
No, this is incidence relation, excuse me. The incidence, so this is F1, 3, 4, and this is F1, 2. This is classical, but it's another subject. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.